everybody. It is 10:01 p.m. Central Time on Sunday, December 4th, 2016. And welcome into the Earthquake 3D live stream. I am your host, dutchsinse. We are here monitoring the earthquakes, where we daily recap the events around the planet, and we do issue semi-daily earthquake forecasts for new areas to watch for possible development to take place. And that leads us right into what's happened in the past few hours. Now, I could go into two different areas, but first, let's point out what happened since last night. Now, you may remember a day and a half ago, 2 days ago, we issued an update where there was no activity in the West Pacific at all. And then we got on last night, told you about the new deep earthquake that had happened, talked about what it meant, the 4.5, and told you some areas to watch. And those areas were hit, starting with Papua New Guinea, right east in between the two volcanoes we talked about, 5.0. We were looking for a 5.2. It's acceptable, though. That's within 0.2 of the magnitude expected in the exact spot. Secondly, over here in Indonesia, two things happened in Indonesia. The first thing is right here south of Philippines, right where Philippines meets Indonesia, a series of fives happened. Two fives happened. You don't see those. Those were reported by the Europeans, not by the USGS. Then a 5.7 hit, also a series of fours, all hit in central Philippines. Additionally, a four struck in Taiwan, which was not reported by the USGS either. You can go check that over on the EMSC page. Then you can also see a massive swarm of fours going into fives broke out all along the coast of Japan. So, kicking it off yesterday with that 6.0 up in Alaska, then the deep 4.5, then a series of fives spreading out all the way around the West Pacific, even going out towards Nepal, which actually this is north. Remember we warned yesterday, we were talking about this area right here in India at the Burma border with Myanmar, and it struck just to the north, but it hit with the exact expected magnitude, which was 5.2 to 5.3. So that all happened today just in the West Pacific alone. Then you'll see, of course, a recent deep 6.0 earthquake that happened at 533 kilometers, which is about 325 miles deep. Some agencies have it as high as 6.5. USGS went with 6.0. Europeans went with 6.3. So I'm going to go with a combination between the highest, which is the 6.3 by the Europeans, and I'll say it's probably more like a 6.1 to 6.2. So if it's a 6.1 to 6.2, this of course means we could be definitely seeing a response on this deep earthquake within 24 to 48 hours, 1 to 2 magnitudes larger than the deep earthquake. And it would be a shallower earthquake that would be 1 to 2 magnitudes larger. Well, one magnitude larger, of course, takes us then to 7.1 to 7.2. And two magnitudes takes us to 8.1 to 8.2. Now, of course, I'm leaning towards the lesser of those. We always should lean towards the lesser. I'm not saying downplay it, but the chances of it going to the extreme upper portion of that are less than the chances of it going to just in that 7-ish range. So let's look out for the potential of a mid-range 7, low 7, striking in a silent zone nearby this deep earthquake. When I say nearby, we have to look to about 1,000 to 1,500 kilometers to the east and to the west and to the north. Okay, so that's three different areas. All three will be hit. So to the west, we go out to the Indo-Australian plate, due west of Sumatra, in between Sumatra and the Indo-Australian plate. Let me zoom in on it. Okay, right here. And then going east, we go back into, that looks like, well, that looks like Papua New Guinea. If we really want to go 1,000 kilometers, it's going to put us to Papua New Guinea, and then we'll skip over the area that we were talking about and going back east of the volcanoes here in the Solomon Islands. But I'm more leaning towards Papua New Guinea. It's standing out. Then to the north by 1,500, we go back up into the Izu Ridge, which technically comes out here towards Guam. You see Guam out here, this little tiny island, halfway point. Watch all three halfway points going north. There will be compensation off this deep earthquake. All three areas will be hit. Now, not all three are going to get sevens. Most likely the seven is going to strike. If we are leaning towards the way things developed in the past here, we have to look to the west. So if we look to the west, again, that puts us Sumatra into the Indo-Australian plate with upwelling pressure. But this is going to excite the whole Pacific. Let me put it this way. A deep 4.5 in Fiji just caused all these fives to progress around the plate, even over to the East Pacific. A deep 4.5 and a five that happened a couple days before. But really, we go with the 4.5. It was the most recent. So what does that mean? Well, it means there's a deep six, which is going to perturb the plate much more than a deep 4.5. So a deep six here in the West Pacific means two things. West Pacific is going to go through the roof. We're going to go up a notch from these fives into sixes. We're going to see sixes pretty much in each location in between where these fives have already struck in the next 7 days. 7 days, this is a 7 day forecast at this point with this deep six. We're going to watch for 7 days on this. Again, this is one of the larger deep earthquakes that we've seen in the past several months. So the deep earthquake event carries on. This will cause new eruptions, a frenzy of new eruptions within 3 days, within 72 hours. There's going to be a noticeable increase in eruptions. We only had six yesterday. That'll be, the list is going to go on and on and on with new eruptions over here. Also in the East Pacific as compensation. There's going to be compensation movement all around the plate, the entire plate, East and West Pacific, off of this deep earthquake. Additionally, we're going to see pressure transfer back over to Europe. So as if that wasn't all enough, this is going to increase things back across the Mideast. Everything's going to go up by a magnitude. So take a look at the map now. This is the last 48 hours worth of earthquakes, which itself is actually significant. This is a fair amount of earthquakes in the last 48 hours, considering the day before, everything was quiet. As I told you the day before, when it goes quiet like this, this is usually the sign of something that's coming. Now we know it. It's a rule I'm setting going forward for all forecasting to come, which is when we see a silent event go on in the West Pacific, when the whole West Pacific goes quiet for a day, that's a sign of a coming larger event across the whole West Pacific. Now it's obvious. 24 hours later, here we are. And the earthquakes progressed all the way over into Europe and caused a new swarm back in Italy, topping out at 3.5 so far. So as if we needed any more signs that the pressure's there, the five that we were talking about yesterday has now pushed up into Italy and increased things by a whole magnitude up to, like I said, we'd be looking at those threes and then it's gonna pop in, boom, we're gonna get hit, and it's gonna happen by tomorrow night. By tomorrow night at 10 p.m., I will be reporting to you on that upper four, that again, that 4.7, 4.8 type earthquake to be striking back in Italy. Now, speaking of 4.7, 4.8, 4.0 type earthquakes, check this out, guys. The Midwest, Oklahoma, was just struck by the 4.2. Now, let's go look it up. I'm going to open up a copy of Google Earth, and you guys should be able to hopefully see what I'm looking at here. Okay, there we go. And let me just quickly turn off the little chat box to get it out of the way. So we're going to go get the coordinates. Now, by the way, this comes from the Europeans. Do you guys notice anything? The USGS already downgrading the earthquake to 3.9 to get it right below that 4.0 threshold. We're not going to be playing that game anymore because this is going to cause a superfracture. This is actually big enough to cause other earthquakes at other wells, and I'll explain as we're looking this up. So I'm done with the downgrade game when it comes to the fracking earthquakes, because this one was what we were expecting, and yet again, they're doing the downgrade. So we're going to throw their downgrade out the window, and I'm going to show you where the earthquake struck. You'll understand. Okay, so first of all, let's mark this location for future reference, just so if we ever have to look it up again, we will all remember this, and there's no way I can remember all these. So M4.2 earthquake, December 4th, 2016. And we'll just look just down to the south, right across the road. And we have a pipeline substation, which I've already marked from previous earthquakes that struck the location. But take a look at it, okay? So you can see the pipeline substation here. Then we'll back it out, and you'll see it's part of a greater oil patch. There's frack wells to the west, to the north, to the east, to the south. Every single one of them looking pretty much like this. You can see the oil well out here, the shadow on that. So they're doing oil fracking, not just... What they'll do is they'll inject wastewater down into these old oil wells, and the wastewater will fracture the shale and release gas that otherwise would have just been trapped up in there. Same with the oil. So anyways, frack wells all around here, kind of out in the woods, old, rusted, nasty, but still operational, still there, and definitely the cause of the earthquake. The reason that the earthquake struck there as opposed to anywhere else is because when pressure is coming in across the plate in general, coming from the west to the east, in this case it's coming from the northwest to the southeast, look what's northwest. Okay, if we come in from the northwest, we have a bunch of other operations up in Kansas, right? Well, look what else was struck earlier today, last night. Northern Kansas, and the imagery on that, unfortunately, is from 2014. So you go look at it, you know, they could easily be doing drilling now. We would never know. This also follows the four that was on the West Coast yesterday. So the four in Nevada that they downgraded to 3.9 led to a 4.2 in the Midwest, which it combined with all the other earthquakes on the West Coast to equal that 4.2. That's why it gained a little bit of energy and momentum because of all the other pressure coming across. But if we really want to go with what the USGS says, then there was a 3.9 in Nevada, and they downgraded this earthquake to a 3.9 in the Midwest. So either way you want to look at it, it's proof that pressure transfers from the West Coast to the East Coast in about a day's time. 3.9 leads to 3.9. Does that make sense? Oh, and right in between there, there was a 3.2 also, right about halfway between the state line of Nevada and the earthquake. So a smaller earthquake developed in between those points. I mean, how about that? So even with their downgrades, it matches perfectly. So there it is, guys. I mean, it's proof positive. The people in Oklahoma, you have to look to the west. And this 5.5 this past week that didn't lead to a 5.5 in the Midwest, we've really got to look into what that really was. I think they threw it on the map, personally. That's what I think, personally. But we'll never know. We'll never know. But it appears to me that they may have just put it on there because we were telling everybody there hadn't been any earthquakes reported in Oregon. But anyways, that being said, take a look at the earthquakes that struck in the past few days on the West Coast leading over to the Midwest. So whichever way you want to look at it, if you believe or don't believe that that earthquake struck on the West Coast, the other earthquakes dictate that there should have been a four in the Midwest, and now there has been. So over the next couple days, we're going to have to watch for pressure to transfer further to the east. And this means the areas up on the northeast are going to see an excitement going back up into the 3.0 range on the East Coast, guys. New England, just north of New England, back up into Maine and New Brunswick at the Quebec's border. Okay? What else? Oh, also, the 4.2 here in Oklahoma is now going to lead to another superfracture. Superfracture is a term I had to create when I was studying all this and everybody was in denial about fracking earthquakes. Okay, we were the only people making videos on it entire year of 2011 and 2012, only person talking about it. And so what I noticed is that whenever there's a greater than 4.0 earthquake or near 4.0 earthquake, a larger earthquake at the fracking operations, it actually shakes up the other nearby wells. So let's zoom back in on this particular well, and I'll use it as the example. So a 4.2 struck here. Now they can downgrade it, whatever, it's a four. So the four strikes here, it sends out shock waves that hit these other nearby wells that are drilled thousands of feet down into the ground, connected by some metal pipeline, some concrete casements, up at the shallower levels into the bedrock. Now, what I believe happens is when these greater than 4.0 earthquakes strike, there's a reverberation that happens in that long pipeline that goes down into the ground, like plucking a string on a guitar. And only there is stone, and it's rigid, and it's metal, and it's not going to flux or bend very much. And that causes cracks in the casement that then releases gas and water under high pressure out into areas that it wasn't supposed to go. shallower levels of bedrock, for instance. That then causes other earthquakes that are of similar size. So a 4.2 can lead to another 4 within a few days' time at another nearby well. And when I say nearby, you have to look miles around, because the 4.2 can cause a disturbance many miles out. Enough reverberation, depending on where it is. And there's so many around here, guys. I mean, all over here. The ones that I have marked pale in comparison to the ones that are actually there. And this imagery date is 2014. But they're all over the place. And I mean, for every one that I've got marked, there's probably 10 or 20 here on the old imagery that are not marked. I just got tired of marking them. Someday maybe I'll come in, if I get another year's worth of time, to come in and mark as many of them as I can. But anyways, so the whole county is filled with this stuff, with these different drill points, and the pressure seeks out the weakest spot to release. Now, it is worthy to note, I mean, take a look. This is the spot where the M4.1 or M5.4 struck on November 1st. They downgraded the 5.4 to 4.1 that struck here before. Now we have a 4.2. They downgraded 3.9 striking here. That's what I'm saying. It's like a downgrade game to protect the oil companies. But whatever the reason they're doing that, I kind of don't care at this point, because we can see it on the map here for ourselves. There was a 3.9, 4.2, whatever, striking out in Nevada yesterday that led to the 3.9, 4.2 in the Midwest today. Plain and simple. Additionally, to the south, take a look at this. Central America was struck. South America was struck. But that was a day ago, South America was struck. Remember we were talking about this? Well, look at it now, guys. Last 24 hours, just a few 3.0 earthquakes in South America and a cluster of earthquakes across South Mexico. This is south of the volcanoes that erupted in Mexico, and I haven't looked up volcano discovery today at all. So maybe I should do that before we go any further. Let's go look up the volcanoes that erupted today. This plays into the seismic activity, guys. The volcanoes erupting actually relieve pressure on these plate boundaries. So if there's an eruption, it actually reduces the threat in that particular area for a large earthquake, which is somewhat good news, right? Okay, so how many are on the list today? Three. Okay, this is perfect. We can make note today. Three on the list. This follows, again, the past several days, the fanning out of earthquakes, the spreading out, the 4.5. Going into tomorrow, you're going to see this sucker go right back through the roof. So we have Bagana in Papua New Guinea, Fuego in Guatemala, Copihue in Chile. Three volcanic ash advisories. That's it. Okay, well, technically they have this as December 5th. Hold on. That's today. Three today. Is there anything for yesterday? Okay, since they're international time, they're a little bit ahead of us. Three. Okay, so today, the 4th, Bagana in Papua New Guinea, Langila in Papua New Guinea, Dukono in Indonesia, Sabancaya in Peru, Copihue in Argentina. Okay, so now today, there's already been three. This is going to go back, again, like I said, up through the roof, which means we're going to see several new blasts. This probably is going to include Nicaragua. We'll probably see a new blast in Nicaragua, and maybe even possibly going further north into Guatemala, back at Fuego with a more impressive eruption, something that makes the news with a lot of lava and explosive blasts. Down to the south, I'm probably going to be leaning towards Turrialba showing the activity again, because first of all, it's been erupting for the past several months, but it went quiet over the past several days, and that's going to renew. Why is that going to renew? This sucker over here, guys. This deep earthquake over here is about to send it all back up a whole notch. You can take it up. Basically, this equals 10 deep fives, if you want to look at it. How would we look at this in a deep earthquake cluster? If we saw 10 deep 5.0s striking on top of each other, you guys would be like, Dutch, there's been 10 deep fives here. Watch out, there's going to be a large amount of movement. Well, it takes 10 fives to equal 1.6. So this six equals 10 fives, either or. And so that's a lot of movement here in the far west tip of the Pacific which is going to displace the whole plate. It's going to displace the western portion of the plate off the west coast of the U.S. It's going to cause activity up in Alaska. It's, guys, this is about to, I mean, really, I'm not trying to panic you. I'm not trying to alarm you. This is different from other nights when I can confidently tell you that within the next 72 hours, this six here is going to cause a noteworthy increase to the point where everybody's starting to tune back in and people are starting to pay attention to earthquakes. Now, where is it going to strike? That's the question everybody's probably wondering at this point. And we'll get into that right now. Our silent zones. The silent zones are the spots where there should be earthquakes and there haven't been any recently. Now, if we're looking at 48 hours and you haven't seen any earthquakes in some of these locations, well, they're normally earthquake prone. So Papua New Guinea, Solomon Islands, Vanuatu, going all the way over to eastern Fiji, east of Fiji. This whole area would normally get fours and fives, but there's nothing there. Same with the area to the west. You would normally expect Mount Sinabung right here in the middle to be erupting. You would expect multiple fives and fours to fill this area out over a couple days' time as pressure transfers around and releases. When there's no pressure transfer and release, that's when something's locked and building. Now, the way we determine our silent zones is the spot, it's a spot between the two most recent earthquakes over the last 48 hours. So there's several silent zones. Let me give you an example. One goes from the 5.2 up here just north of India. See this here? Okay. And it goes all the way down here to the 6.3. Well, the 6.3, as I told you, can cause a shallow 7.3 to 8.3, which means we need to watch the zone between the 5.2 and the 6.3 for the larger earthquake to potentially strike, if it's going to strike to the west. Same with the silent zone to the east. We watch the middle point of the silent zone for the potential release. Same with the area to the north. We have a silent zone developing across Philippines, Taiwan, and South Japan. The middle point goes just northeast of Taiwan. And we have to add in, again, the deep earthquake down below, which should put pressure up to the north. However, most of the pressure should transfer to the west, as I told you. Why? Westward pressure transfer. Take a look at the screen. Okay, this is a graphic we put out this past week, but it's held true for the last 7 years of research that I've done. Took forever to put this on the map. By the way, Big Solar now putting red arrows on his maps, guys. Anyways, copy. So, we check it out. Take a look at this. Again, when you see the red arrows on the map, you can see which way the pressure is intended to transfer. So, we have a deep earthquake marked where our letter D is. By the way, we've seen past deep earthquakes here enough to know that the pressure transfers across Indonesia, and as I told you, it goes out to the west. That means areas to the west are going to be excited all the way out to the points where we have X marks. Well, you see we have an X mark down in South Africa. South Africa is going to be hit again down near Zambia in Ethiopia. Secondly, follow the arrows up to the north. These areas are going to be re-excited. There's no way around it. So if you can find the halfway point, look where Mount Sinabung is. The red arrow goes right along it. Here in western Sumatra, just another example, the westward pressure transfer, the larger earthquake will strike to the west. Then we'll also see additional large earthquakes. And when I say large, we're going one magnitude larger than what we've currently seen, which was all fours and fives, which means we're going to go back up to sixes, low six. 6.0, 6.1. Why? Because pressure as it transfers to the north is going to lose a little bit of momentum coming up from the south. It has to pass underneath all these volcanoes. It's going to re-excite the volcanoes. They're going to blast. It's going to relieve some of that pressure, and it's going to go down by a notch. But it's still going to be higher than everything we saw this past week. So this is over 7 days. But I'm more leaning, this West Pacific movement is all going to happen in the next 72 hours. Then we're going to see pressure transfer back over to the East Pacific off this. The whole plate is being displaced right now. I'm willing to bet if you were to go check those charts that Mr. BBB was looking at, BBB333, with the vibration showing that we've seen before at past times of heightened unrest in the Pacific, that vibration is the plate adjusting itself, the actual Pacific plate moving. And it causes the whole continent to detect it. And it shows up as this low-grade vibration detected across all the stations, and then some of the stations showing huge breaks that aren't explained by anybody. Again, that's the plate adjusting. I think it's the plate adjusting, which means the plate's going to adjust this week over the next few days, and we're going to see new activity off the West Coast, and it's going to be noteworthy in size compared to where it was over the past couple weeks. It's going to be unignorable. So does that mean it's going to go above 6 this past week that I was wrong? Let's set it at the upper 5. And it's going to strike pretty close to land. It's going to strike right along the Gorda Escarpment. Gorda Escarpment, Northwest California, just off the coast of Eureka. Why there? Well, guys, first of all, it's prime. Secondly, the area up off the coast of Oregon supposedly was hit. Well, if that's the case, it should strike to the south now. Why? Lateral fracture zone. You see this? See these? East and west. Okay, they go across. And they go all the way over here to the West Pacific. And our deep earthquake is displacing the whole West Pacific. Which means almost every single spot where you see an east and west lateral fracture zone that's pretty large. I mean, you can see them. They go all the way down the Pacific. Every single one of these where they meet up with the plate is going to see noteworthy increase in activity. So it's not just going to be Northwest California. You're also going to see an activity down in Santa Barbara. You're going to also see activity pick up back down in the Gulf of California, also off the coast of Mexico, also off the coast of Central America, and that leads us back down into our volcanic eruptions. Also off the coast of Peru and Ecuador, also off the coast of central Chile, also off the coast of south central Chile, and also all the way down here at the south central Pacific. This is all going to happen this week. Everywhere where you see one of these east and west fracture zones going across the plate is going to see an excitement. I think this is the reason they exist in the first place. Pressure coming across from the West Pacific, creating these east and west fracture zones that go right up to the plate. That's where the pressure is going to come across. That's where the pressure is going to hit. It's not going to stop there, though. It's then going to further transfer all the way across the plates and go out to our east and west fracture zones out at the Mid-Atlantic Ridge that absorb the pressure. This exerts the pressure, the larger zones, and the smaller receiving zones here capture it all the way down the plate. So when the pressure hits South America, just as this past week, when it hits in here, it's going to cluster up in here. It already is, but this is yesterday's earthquake, so let's get those off the map. Those are going to transfer down here to the south and lead to a single 5 by tomorrow. But Central America, that's going to increase as well. That will be seen most likely topping out at a 6 to 6.1. Where? Most likely in Bolivia, east of Chile. So let's put a full 5-day watch on that. Should take probably at least 2 days for the pressure to transfer over and for the plate to adjust. And then that gives us a 2 to 3 day leeway. So 5-day watch for the Bolivia 6.0 earthquake, which, I mean, it's not every day we talk about Bolivia. Oh, okay. So what else are we watching for? Well, again, over here in Europe, now that there's been a new cluster of earthquakes back over here in China, you see the 5.2, going into tomorrow, we're going to see a return of 4s back down here in Greece and Turkey. Now, not just anywhere in Greece and Turkey, we're talking right along the plate boundary. And in case you're not familiar with these plate boundaries, let me just go ahead and open up one of the plate boundary maps from the USGS, if we have one. Let's see, that was the wrong one to click. Here we go. Okay, so when we take a look at this, you'll see a red line that goes through Nepal and then goes west across Pakistan and Afghanistan, bends down to the south and goes across Oman, makes a split, goes down to the Gulf of Aden, goes up here through Iran, then into Turkey. You see that red line? That's put by the USGS. It's the plate boundaries. So following that plate boundary line, from where our star is, the star is putting pressure to the west. And when it puts pressure to the west, where's it going to hit? It's going to hit, of course, right here at the bend at Pakistan and Afghanistan. That's going to put pressure to the south, which is going to hit these fracture zones here. It's going to put pressure to the west across the Gulf of Oman. We're going to see this all develop out in upper 4s. There'll be a little bit of loss of momentum off of the earthquake that starts where the star is. At a 5.2, 5.3, it'll go down to 5 to 4.9 by the time it hits over here at the border of Pakistan and Afghanistan. It will maintain most of its momentum from that 4.9-ish down here through Iran and down here through the Gulf of Aden, south of Oman, right there. Okay, let me see that. Okay, well, then it's going to push to the west from there. The 4.8 and 4.9 in Iran and down at the Gulf of Aden is going to push up into South Europe, down into Turkey. So the two plate boundaries meet here. It's going to recombine the total, and we'll see a release west of Cyprus, east of Crete, in this bend right here, the combined total of the two 4.8 and 4.9s that are supposed to strike in Iran down at the Gulf of Aden, and that will lead us back into 4.9 to 5, striking back down here in Greece. And in, again, that's south of Turkey, but that's Crete. Crete is Greece. Turkey is there. Turkey's in green on the map here, and Crete is in like a reddish orange. So you can see it's right in between there. That's then going to re-excite things back along the plate boundary to the west as pressure transfers to the west-northwest. You can see it on my plate progression map here. The red arrows take us across Italy and then going out through Europe. By the way, I had somebody report to me that an earthquake struck in the UK, that it showed up on the seismologist page for the EMSC. They sent me screenshots and everything like that, but I went to the link and it said that this link does not exist anymore. So I don't know what that was. I do not know what that was. It didn't have any magnitude information. It just showed a bunch of stations detecting something. So I don't know if that means an earthquake was detected or they were asking me about it. But if you, whoever sent it to me, they were anonymous. I didn't recognize the email and there was nothing else in it. So just let me know if what that was, if you're listening right now and you get it. Please contact me back. I'd like to know more. So today, what happened? Again, we topped out at 3.5. If you go check the station information on this, several stations reporting in above 4. It is what it is. They went with 3.5, but that's consistent with what we were expecting so far. So within 48 hours, we should see this 4.9-ish, 4.9 to 5 earthquake striking between Crete and Cyprus, and then that's going to re-excite things back in Italy again, which means you're going to go back up to more like 4.5, 4.4, 4.5, but you're still going to be hit by tomorrow due to the previous 5 that hit. So we're looking 48 hours out on this. You're going to get double hit. First, you're going to get hit by the leftovers off this 5 that struck down in Greece yesterday. Like I said, 4.7, 4.8 topping out, or a swarm equal there too. There's the 5 on the map from yesterday. Okay, and it re-excited things back in Italy, but we still haven't topped out yet. So it's going to top out, again, most likely in that 4-ish range. And then by tomorrow, new activity, another near 5 down in South Europe. I guess that's technically the Mediterranean. And that's going to then put another warning out for Italy to be on watch for a new swarm of earthquakes to develop. And with this new 6.3, man oh man, things are even going to pick up even more by the end of this week. So I'm only issuing that 48-hour watch for what's already happened here in Asia. And again, this is going to re-excite things up. You see any larger earthquakes that strike here by tomorrow or the next day? That really is going to mean Europe's back on the menu for large earthquake activity. Same with the west coast of the U.S. You've got to look over to the West Pacific to see the activity. So all in all, guys, you need to look at the silent zones. I'm here to be here for you to, you know, of course, answer your questions and analyze things and do nightly updates. But the situation can change fluid. A new deep earthquake can switch everything up. Sometimes the time frame, the turnaround, is just 12 hours or less sometimes. But usually it's about a day or two. So we usually have some time between the time where our deep earthquake strikes and our shallower, larger movement begins, which is enough time for you guys to get the warning out to your friends, family, and loved ones. If they live in the West Pacific, or if they live on the West Coast, or if they live in South America, if they live anywhere in one of these areas or around one of these areas, or they're just concerned. Because guess what? The Midwest U.S. and East Coast U.S. are tied in to this deep earthquake over here in the West Pacific. You will see an increase on the East Coast of the U.S. by the end of this coming week off this 6 over here. and the Midwest, it could go noteworthy. It really could. It could get large if we get a noteworthy earthquake off the west coast of the U.S. You just saw it. 3.9 on the west coast leads to 3.9 in the Midwest, regardless of their downgrades. But I say they're both 4.2s. The other one was, it was a 4.0 that if you go looked at the charts, it said 4.2, and then they downgraded it to 3.9. Well, now here it is again. A 4.2 downgraded to 3.9. They're within a day of each other, 1,000 miles apart, right along the edge of the craton. And professionals denied that pressure transfers from the West Coast to the Midwest to the East Coast, which is exactly why I put out this plate boundary progression transfer information that my viewer, Sumo, over in the UK, translated for me and put onto a map for you to see. So I don't just have to wave my mouse over the area and tell you this is the way the pressure transfers. You can watch for it yourself. Okay? So, that all being said, it is now officially go time. The alarm bells have sounded. You need to be on your heightened alert and be watching closely over this coming starting part of the week. And definitely, if you're in one of the areas, you need to pay attention on a hourly basis or semi-hourly basis to what's happening. Now, there's only a few ways I know to tell you to pay attention to what's happening. One way, of course, is that you have the links, which are provided down below this video, and you can sit there and hit refresh over and over again and look at their little crappy maps. You can keep this open. It doesn't cost anything. Keep it open and watch for the earthquakes to strike. That's another way to do it. Regardless of which way you choose to monitor the earthquakes, at this point, we should all be paying attention. But the people in these areas, so if you live in one of these areas that's currently silent, you live on the west coast of the U.S., you live over in Asia, if you live in South Europe, guys, you might want to start paying attention now, and you'll see it coming to you. You'll see the excitement fan out by tomorrow. We're only talking about fives right now. We'll be talking about sixes in the next 48. And I'll be like, look at all these sixes. And then it's going to be like, okay, are you ready? I hope you guys are ready. And then it'll start striking in our more populated areas. So have your plans. Be prepared. Don't be scared. There's no reason to be scared now. You can see it coming like a train off in the distance. You can see this large pressure coming out at you, and it's coming and coming and coming, and it follows the tracks, usually. There's a few rare instances where the pressure doesn't follow these tracks. A few times. Mostly, predominantly, the pressure follows these arrows. I mean, I don't think anybody should be shocked by it, except for the spots around the edges of the cratons. You know, most people would expect that the edges of the plates would move, you know, where the Pacific meets South America and North America. That would be expected. But the other spots where we see lateral movement and across the entire Pacific and across the entire oceans, that's new. That's a new discovery that I've made in the past 7 years on this. Which way all the pressure transfers. It's amazing. So, peace out to my people, guys. Peace out to my people. And I want to wish you all a very, very huge much love for all the support you've given me over the past several years. We've been doing this for 7 years at this point, and it's been long. We've fought and fought and fought for it. And, you know, it's just, I couldn't have done it without you guys. So thank you so much for being part of that. And thank you for sharing my information. If you're new here, please subscribe. And things are about to go through the roof, so stay tuned. I'll be back on. Every time we hear a big ding, I'm going to be on here doing a report and saving it as a video on my channel so you guys can share it. Don't say you weren't warned this week. Don't say you weren't warned. Don't be caught off guard. And when you see the news and people freaking out on a large earthquake or large earthquakes, you can honestly say to people, look, we knew it was coming. And they'll say, how did you know it was coming? And you'll say, well, there was that deep earthquake that just struck over in the West Pacific. Didn't that displace the plate? And other people might say, what are you talking about? I didn't hear about any plate displacement. And you'll say, well, it's because we're doing the studying, we're getting the warnings out, and it's based upon these new things we're discovering. It's wild. Okay, so peace out to all my people. Hope you have a good rest of the weekend. It was good drinking a beer last night, I suppose. I was delivered some bad news, but it is what it is. You know, that's how it goes. I'll have a good time, and as soon as I'm, like, almost done having a good time, it just gets smashed. But that's how it goes. All right, guys. All right. I hear a cat meowing around out there, and I'm going to save this as a video on my channel so you can share it and get it out to people and just tell them. Oh, if people ask, you know, why doesn't he do regional updates? I do. You can fast forward it to the spot where I'm moving my mouse over the specific country that I'm talking about and tell the people to watch it at this point in the video. He talks about South America at 25 minutes into the video, that kind of stuff. I would do updates for each country or each region, but that would be about 5 or 6, 7 videos a day, and that would just desensitize my whole crowd, and it would become, you know, I don't know. I just think 7 or 8 videos a day on different regions would be, you know, some over inundate YouTube with my content kind of thing. So anyways, again, it's better to do it once a night, recap it. Some nights there's nothing that happens. Sometimes there's very little that happens. Other nights there's a 45 minute to an hour long update that can be done just showing earthquakes, not even talking about a forecast. So we'll be into it, and I'll be here. And if you live in a coastal area, when we start talking about earthquakes above 7, when you get above 7, that's when you can start to get a little bit of wave activity, you know, 2-3 foot waves. And you get above 8, that then causes 5-8 foot waves. And you get above 9, and you start getting these earthquake, these seismic events like in Japan, and that caused massive waves that were, you know, 30, 40 feet high. So we're not talking about 9, and we're not really talking about 8. We're more talking about 7 in the West Pacific. So we're not worried about major wave activity from tsunamis or anything like that. But if the earthquake strikes on land as opposed to sea, well, then we're talking about serious damage to structures in the West Pacific, in specific, because the building codes there are not exactly earthquake proof. Okay. So, all right, I'm done. Please subscribe. Like I said, that's how I grow my channel. I'm trying to get it to 170,000 by Christmas so I can just like say I accomplished something this year. All right, guys. Peace out. Much love. Hey, I just got a personal message telling me I didn't talk about New Zealand. Hold on, guys. You're right, I didn't. I got sidetracked. Sorry, guys. Okay, here's the deal. Real quick, we can just sum this up down here in New Zealand by telling you guys, pressure has transferred all the way down south and west, going out to a fracture zone off of Australia. I don't even know the name of the fracture zone. Let me get it. USGS has it on their site. The Krenstof Ridge. I'd never heard of it before, okay? So anyways, pressure transferred all the way down and across, but it has nowhere to go. You can see these go north and south, and they dead end into, well, to the north, Australia, and to the south, Antarctica. I think these are like roadblocks or barriers. So the pressure only was able to go across a few distances, a few of those, and it hit and it caught. So the deep earthquakes up to the north certainly displaced most of New Zealand over the past day and a half. That 4.5 and the other activity caused activity down to the south and to the east. Now, I explained yesterday that I think these deep earthquakes are actually putting pressure over to the east and to the west. And in this case, it also looks like it put equal pressure to the south. So how do we know it's equal pressure? Well, look at the 5 to the west, look at the 5 to the south, look at the 5.2, I guess you could call that a 5, over to the east, look at the 5 to 5.1 over to the northeast, okay, and it all makes sense, right? I mean, these are the earthquakes that struck over the past day. So what do we say? That means the pressure has spread out equally across the whole area, which has reduced the threat of a large earthquake in New Zealand itself. Which means the people in New Zealand, while you do have deep earthquakes that struck to the north, the potential for a very large earthquake is slim, and I mean real slim. The areas to the north might be struck, the middle point of the silent zone between the deep earthquake and the earthquakes here at the, I guess, the north part of the South Island, south of Wellington. So if we go halfway between the deep earthquakes to the north and those earthquakes, this puts us just north of our catcher's mitt position, north of New Zealand by just a little bit. And the magnitudes between that could only go up to 6.5. Since there's a deep 4.5, that could lead to a shallow 5.5 to 6.5. Now there's already been fives down to the south, southeast, southwest, and west. And now a 5.1 recently over the past few hours, just to the east. So I think it's pretty obvious that when you get pressure spreading out like this, the potential for a large earthquake decreases exponentially, which is why last night I told you we would see fives spreading out all around the plate today. And look at it, man. Again, take a look at it. Look at this. Since my update last night, spreading out from that deep 4.5. And the deep 4.5 is pretty much right where the 5.1 is, the white 5.1, the most recent earthquake that you see now. So spreading out from there, what do we have? Well, we have three earthquakes going out to the west, three earthquakes going out to the southeast, and we have one deep 6.0 that's going to re-excite things up further to the west and further to the north and further to the southwest, I guess I should say, and further to the northwest. So, I mean, it's pretty obvious. The pressure has spread out from Fiji, and the threat of a large earthquake in New Zealand has diminished, and the most you could go up to would be 6.5, and the chances of it striking are going to be north of the main island. So let's also turn on the GeoNet here. This is something that we can always use. It's the New Zealand last 30 earthquakes, and this is going to show us everything that struck over the past 30, obviously. And we'll turn down the rings. So when you take a look at this, the largest earthquake of the bunch in the last 30 is a 3.8 that struck near Wellington. Okay, this kind of fits with what we were talking about yesterday, that we would see activity near Wellington, we would see the smaller earthquakes continuing along the plate boundary, movement across the North Island up to what? Up to the catcher's mitt. So catcher's mitt position is the one that should be on watch up to the north of the catcher's mitt. And again, it looks like a catcher's mitt. It's kind of a receiving U shape there. And so the threat there, I know people were talking about, some person was issuing warnings saying that there was, you know, a huge earthquake impending for New Zealand and everybody needed to be on warning. I don't see that. I mean, I might be wrong. If I'm wrong, I'm sorry, but I don't see that building there right now. Your largest potential goes up to 6.5 and it most likely will strike out to sea. If it, you know, more like 5.5 to 6.5 in between that range. So it's a factor of 10. I mean, it's a magnitude of, you know, a whole magnitude increase, which is a factor of 10. Okay? Not that big of a deal, because the people down in New Zealand are used to the 7.0 activity now that shook everything up so bad that a 5 strikes and it causes a little bit of shaking on maybe like the northern tip of the island or something. That's not going to be that big of a deal to people, I don't think. If I'm wrong, I'll stand corrected. I'll issue a public apology and correction for telling people that there wasn't going to be a large earthquake when big one hits, because I don't think, I don't see one developing there right now. If I do, you can bet I'll be on here telling you about it. But right now, the threat exists over here in the West Pacific by our new deep earthquake. And the larger they are, the bigger the movement that happens off the transpiration of the pressure up through the underside of the plate. All right, so that's our update for the night now. Sorry I didn't touch on New Zealand, guys, but I got sidetracked with talking about this deep earthquake and the threat that exists over here in the other areas. So if you live in New Zealand, much love, and you can, you know, maybe hopefully wipe your brow a little bit. If I'm wrong, you can come here and string me up. Oh, all right, guys. Peace out to my people. Much love.